Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Filler with Eyes in the Sky. What's up this week? There's an awesome planetary alignment happening over in the morning sky, and I will share with you not only how to see all the bright, easy planets, but the dim, difficult ones. And that's the important part. We want to be able to see all the planets, right? So let's start with where and when. We will be looking in the southeastern part of the sky in general, even though we're going to look all the way from east, northeast through south, but generally facing towards the southeast. You should be able to see everything in your visual field of view. Jupiter is going to be very obvious, nice and high towards the southeast. If you look down and left towards the eastern part of the sky, Venus will be nice and brilliant. Between them will be the moon, and the moon will be over there depending on what morning you are looking. As well, it's going to slide this direction. I'll do more on that a little bit later. And then all the way towards the south, if you follow the line of Venus, Mars, Jupiter, all the way out towards the south, you can also spot where Saturn is at. Those are the easy ones. Those are fairly bright. The dimmest one is Saturn at like magnitude, you know, one or zero. It's pretty bright. Shouldn't be difficult to find at all. The difficult one to see, as far as the naked eye planets, is going to be Mercury. And that is because it's perpetually stuck in twilight. As I like to say, it's kind of, at its best, it's caught between darkness and twilight. And there's a golden 15 minutes that you can really see it at its best, whether it's in the evening sky or the morning sky. And that happens to be that 30 to 45 minutes, either before sunrise or after sunset, that Mercury is really high enough up to be able to see it, and also bright enough, and the sky is dark enough that you have enough contrast to be able to spot that little quick-moving innermost planet that is really kind of the challenging one. And fortunately, we have Jupiter, Mars, the Moon, and Venus to point right the way towards where it's at, but the timing is very important. So for me, I'm going to be out at about 4:35 in the morning on Friday morning because that's 45 minutes before my local sunrise. And as you watch what happens over the next 15 minutes, it rises up. It actually goes, for me, from about 4 degrees up, which is really difficult to see because there's a lot of atmosphere it's going through, all the way up to 7 degrees, which actually kind of gets it up and above a little bit more of that atmosphere, making it simpler to see. However, you can see how the sky starts to get brighter, so you start to lose it. There's really kind of a, maybe, you know, you want to be looking kind of that whole time, not directly at it necessarily every single minute of that, but definitely keep looking back every minute or two to see if you can spot where that innermost planet is. If you are having trouble and don't see it naked eye and you're getting towards that, you know, half hour before sunrise time, not to worry. Again, follow your line, start at Venus, and bring out some binoculars, and that will help you spot it. The planet is a little more than a field of view and a half from Venus. So if you start at Venus and head towards where the sun will rise, obviously don't use the binoculars after the sun has risen. But if you head towards that direction, you should be able to spot Mercury. However, one thing I do want to point out is if we look right here and zoom in, there is a star there too that's around the same magnitude. So Mercury is going to be the higher one. It should be a little brighter, but Mercury is definitely the one that's going to be up and to the left. So just don't confuse the star that happens to be lower. It's also going to be, that star is going to be through more atmosphere, so it should be more difficult to see, and Mercury should be the one that you spot first anyway. That's how you find where Mercury is. Now, if we want to find where Uranus is at, we have to kind of get rid of where the moon is going to be for us so that we can, there we go, there's Uranus hiding over here, like that. It is partway between Venus and Mars. The moon will be kind of past it on either side on the 24th and 25th. So that actually could cause a problem if there's a little bit of additional light over there that way. But if you want to try to find it, I'm going to back up to that 45 minutes before because that gives us a little bit more darkness. That's actually a better time to try to be looking for it. So if you spot Mercury early, or if you can't see Mercury right away, you can start looking for this instead. Notice this star over here, that is a 2.5 magnitude star known as Menkar in the constellation of Cetus. It forms a pretty good triangle here with Venus and the moon. or excuse me, Venus and Uranus, and we are then able to hopefully find where that planet is by getting some of this other stuff out of the way because it kind of blocks it. So we can use this star right here, which will be in the same field of view as this 2.5 magnitude star. So you can literally just kind of like look from Venus across the horizon like that. And then if we use our binoculars and we head up, there's that other star, both in the same field of view. Even if you've got a 5-degree field of view with some 10 by 50 binoculars, you should be able to get both in there. Follow that same line upward in this direction like this. And what you're going to not see first is necessarily where Uranus is, but you might see these two stars, which point right at the planet. So if you go past Uranus, that's fine. See those two stars right next to each other and go, aha, I found them. They should be almost the same magnitude as Uranus. Boom, head right back to it. Just don't confuse it with these two stars, which are further apart. But if you follow that line again, it's about a field of view and a half to two fields of view as you head over that way. You should be able to find where the seventh planet in the solar system is. Now, to find where Neptune is at, that's the tricky one because the sun is rising. It is not as bright as Uranus is. It is an eighth magnitude object. So as we zoom in over here, there's Neptune. If you look for the line that Jupiter and Saturn form here, like that, Neptune is on that line. So you're not actually going to go all the way across that way. But what we are going to do is imagine that line by starting at Jupiter with our binoculars. Or if binoculars are not enough oomph, then you may want to use your finder scope on a telescope because it should have the same field of view as binoculars. And then head over in that direction towards where Saturn is. And we're going to notice that there's a pattern in the sky that is kind of like a hockey stick, like this. So there's four stars, they're all kind of equal brightness. You'll also notice that there's these two stars down here that form this little quadrilateral thing. So this is not difficult to identify. Once you found that, you're gonna go, aha, I found the hockey stick, oh yes. So remember this line because we're gonna follow that line as we go up the hockey stick like this. We're gonna follow that, now we're gonna go that bottom of the hockey stick line like this over here. There's a star right there that is almost exactly the same magnitude as Neptune, and Neptune is right above it, right there. It is not bright. It is an object that is 7.8 magnitude. This star right here is just a hair brighter at 7.3 magnitude, about a half magnitude brighter. But if you can see the star, you might be able to pick out Neptune. What's interesting about Neptune is that it really does look blue. It's not like a blue-white star. I mean, it really does look blue. It also looks very small in binoculars, so you may not pick up that color, and that's okay. But if you're using a large enough telescope, you should be able to see that blue color, especially if this telescope is larger, because it's really kind of obvious. The one thing, again, you're going to be fighting is that, you know, brightening of the twilight morning. So you might need to do this over a morning or two to be able to see both the outer planets and Mercury, especially if you're trying to use a telescope to be able to see where Neptune is. But the great thing about Neptune is you can get up earlier and look for that first and then kind of work your way down and then look for Mercury last. You don't necessarily have to go in the order that I did. However, there's a bonus. And the bonus is that I talked about earlier, the moon. So if we bring up our date here again, we can see on the 23rd, the moon is close to Mars. It kind of splits that difference on the 24th. That's what I'm going to be looking on Friday morning. It gets close to Venus on the 25th, and it's really close on the 26th. Now what happens on the 27th is it's near Mercury, but it's also really, really, really small. If we zoom in, look how thin that crescent is. That's an old moon right there. Even if we go back to the 26th, that's a pretty old moon and not much of a crescent either. But on the 27th, that's not a lot. You might actually use Mercury to find the moon on that day. So anyway, that is your guide on how to find all eight planets. And I know you're thinking, wait, Dave, you only talked about seven because you did Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune. But all you got to do is look down at your feet and you can see the eighth planet, which is the planet Earth. And I would be remiss if I did not say that I still think Pluto is a planet, so there should be nine, but the International Astronomical Union decided otherwise. despite the fact that I think their criteria doesn't make any sense. And so Pluto should be a planet. But in any case, of the 8 major planets that are still technically in existence, you can see all of them this week and weekend if you have some clear skies and a really low horizon to catch Mercury. I encourage you to do it. It's fun. And even if you're tired, it's totally worth it. So get out there and do it. I'm David Fuller with Eyes on the Sky, wishing you clear and dark skies.